the kitchen, plastic.
In the living room,
plastic.
In the bathroom,
plastic.
Even the toilet contains plastic. Wait, is that actually bad?
Hey everyone, Dana here. This video was created in cooperation with the Petra Kelly Stiftung, and we'll get to why they're so awesome later. I mean, besides the fact that they sponsored this video, of course. So be sure to watch the whole video to the end to find out why someone would want to, you know, sponsor me to film with my toilet. You're curious now, aren't ya? Mm-hmm. Okay, so plastic is all over my apartment and in all parts of my life. Is this a bad thing? That's kind of tricky. Plastic, I would say, is basically both a blessing and a curse. A few of the pros of plastic include it's lightweight, it's flexible, it doesn't corrode like metals do, it can be really durable, it can be really thin, it can be used to create waterproof and watertight things, and it doesn't usually break when dropped, which is great for someone like me who drops a lot of things. Plastic has so many different amazing properties that make it so great for so many different things in our lives, and so many very important life-saving and life-changing things as well. Just one of the many examples, you know, thanks to plastic, we have shatterproof glass in cars. Imagine driving a car with just a normal glass windshield. Very dangerous. Plastic is also great for airplanes and ships because, you know, it doesn't rust, and that's always good. And plastic is quite cheap to produce compared to other things. Producing things with plastic has meant that more people can afford many of the goods and services that are made with plastic, including, you know, for example, lowering the price of many kinds of clothes. You know those terms on clothing tags when it says that the clothes are made of like nylon, polyester? That's actually plastic. And the fact that many things made with plastic, including clothing, have become more affordable is on the one hand really great. Plastic has helped to increase the quality of life for many people around the world, and that is so, so important. You know, that absolutely cannot be understated. And especially if cheaper clothing simply meant that we bought the same amount of clothes just for less money, and that more people had access to these clothes, that would be really wonderful. But the reality is that that's not the case. Having so much cheaper clothing available has led us to buying more cheap clothing and then treating that cheap clothing like it's disposable, rather than buying the same amount of clothing as before, just for less money. We used to have two fashion seasons each year, neither of which did I ever really know anything about because I'm not really that fashionable, but I did know it was spring, summer, and fall, winter. Now there are 52 seasons, little micro seasons that I also can't keep up with. Cheap fast fashion is pumping out 52 little micro seasons every year with new clothes always appearing in stores, driving that desire for always new clothing. And because the clothes are so cheap, we often don't even think about it. We just buy new things and then treat them as though they were disposable. And I gotta say, I know that I'm definitely guilty of this too. You know, buying something new and thinking like, nah, it's no big deal. It's only 5 euros. If I don't like it, I'll just throw it away. It's okay. But when it comes to cost, there's a lot more to think about than just the money that we're paying at the checkout. You know, there's a much higher cost than what's on that price tag. We often forget to take into account the cost of tossing that thing into the trash, the cost that that has on our planet, and the cost on our planet to create all those clothes in the first place, and then dispose of them when we throw them out a month or two later, because they're not fashionable anymore, or we just don't like them, or for whatever reason. So I would say that one of the biggest cons of plastic, and the one that I'm focusing on here in this video, is how cheap plastic has created a Wegwerfmentalität. In German, in English, a throwaway mentality in our society. Clothes and many other plastic items are so cheap that we just buy them, and if they get dirty or we don't like them, want something new, we just throw them away. Companies, for example, used to have glass bottles for drinks that they used over and over and over again, but nowadays, plastic has made these one-use bottles so much cheaper and less of a hassle for companies, so that's what we get. So much effort went into making this shirt and this bottle, and with our throwaway mentality, we as a society don't really take that into consideration as much anymore, you know? With plastic so cheap in our society, it's often cheaper and easier to just buy a new one than it is to try to figure out how to repair the old one. And we don't usually see the consequences of us throwing so much out either. You know, I mean, I toss something in the trash and hey, look at that, someone comes and just makes it disappear every week. Almost feels like magic, right? Out of sight, out of mind. But it's not magic, far from it. Our trash is going somewhere. Specifically, some of it even lands in Southeast Asia and our oceans. Did you know about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch? And not great as in, hey, it's great. That's great as in like really big. You can see on this graphic how huge it is compared to Germany. I mean, holy crap, look at that. Right now, as we're talking, there is a humongous floating garbage patch in the Pacific Ocean, and we've put it there. And it's also gonna remain there, at least in the form of microplastics. And you know, I had heard of this garbage patch before, in German, Müllstrudel, but I did not realize just how massive it is until I saw this picture with Germany sitting in the pile of trash, not even taking up half of it. So that's why it's the Great Garbage Patch, because it's really big. Not because it's great, because it's not great. Very not great. This graphic, as well as all the others that you've seen in this video, came from Plastic Atlas. And wow, I can only say that I have learned so much reading this. The Plastic Atlas is an information brochure all about plastic and our world, from how plastic literally changed our lives on this planet, the pros and the cons, how it has changed our clothing, the world around us, our way of life, and how it's hurting us and what we can do about it. While reading this, I was honestly sitting there saying out loud to Stefan every like 2 minutes or so, oh my God, did you know this? Oh my God, Stefan, you have to listen to this. Oh my God, Stefan, come here, come here, come here. You have to hear this. You have to look at this graphic. You have to look at this. So well written, so thorough and informative, but the articles are not too long. Each article is just 2 pages and there are so many colorful little graphs and charts. It really keeps you involved and interested in learning more. The magazine is printed in German, but you can download the PDF version in English as well as German. And I'll put a link down in the description below, so I definitely recommend checking it out. It's free, and there's really so much information. And I mean, reading the PDF doesn't even use any extra paper. Definitely check that out to get more informed on this topic, you know, way more than I could talk about in this one video here. So the question now is, what can we do? Plastic is here, and for better or for worse, I don't really see plastic going away anytime soon. So instead of how can we live without plastic, the question that I'm gonna ask is, how can we live better with plastic and with less plastic? And I wanna stress that all is not lost. It is possible to drastically reduce the amount of plastic we use and live better with the plastic we have, especially if we decide as a society that we're going to, that we're gonna make this a priority. The town of Capannori, Italy, for example, is the first city in Europe to implement a zero waste strategy. I think that's so awesome. The town decided to make this a priority and created a plan to match, overhauling many of their systems in order to do so. And very importantly, the city has helped the residents to become as zero waste as possible. I think that's so important, you know, that the city actively helped the residents and made it easier for them to incorporate this big change into their life, because it is a big change, and not just leaving them on their own to do it themselves. In Freiburg, Germany, there's the Freiburg Cup Initiative, where a bunch of cafes and shops in the city offer coffees to go in a reusable cup with a Pfand system. I think you already know how much I love Pfand. I've talked about it in so many videos. Pfand is a deposit fee system. And I mean, that's something. Like, that's not nothing. At least it's something. It's a start. With big rehauls of the whole system, like in Kapanori, and even small initiatives like in Freiburg, together as a society, we can make changes in how we live better with plastic. Yes, it is absolutely important and really, really great when individuals make changes on their own at home to use less plastic or be more environmentally sustainable overall. Totally, 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 this does not in any way negate that. The Heinrich Böll Stiftung, the same organization that put out the Plastic Atlas, also created a little advice brochure for how individual people can reduce plastic in their own lives. And I will definitely link to that down in the description box as well. I've already started trying to implement a few of the things that I read in there in my own life. So yeah, definitely check that out as well. But if we as a society decide to make these changes together, if we decide to change the framework we live in, we can really do a lot to live better with plastic and live using less plastic without it overwhelming us as individual people trying to do it alone. On this point, I also want to stress that to reach a solution, we cannot only focus on the personal responsibility of consumers. No. Rather, we have to consider the role of big corporations. We have to. You know, the production of plastic has increased enormously in the last 2 decades, also due to the fact that fracking of gas has become so cheap. And a few corporations who control the market have started to produce a lot of plastic totally independent from the market demand or need for it. So it really should be both an increased environmental sensibility on the side of the consumer, as well as more pressure to reduce the production of plastic altogether. One more thing that I think is really important that I really want to stress before I wrap up the video. Okay, so every time that I see people talking about how they try to use less plastic or they try to do things that are better for the environment in general, you know, trying to reduce fossil fuel consumption, whatever. Every time I then see other people claiming that whatever those people are saying or the little things that they're trying to do actually mean nothing because they are not perfect. And I am so sick of that. First of all, it's not about being perfect. And it's not about changing everything you do individually in your own life overnight. You know, people make changes at their own pace, and every little change is important and valid regardless. And I think it is just so ridiculous when a person who is making a few small changes gets put down by someone doing nothing. And there are also some changes that people are able to make quicker than other changes, and quicker or slower than other people. And anyway, this is such a huge, important thing. This is not something that we should be putting on the shoulders of individual people to handle all alone. No. As I said, this needs to be about deciding as a society that we're gonna make big societal changes together, not having a few individual people trying to carry the whole burden to save us from our own collective waste. A quick example from my own life, I would really love to shop more in packaging-free stores, but as of filming this video, I believe Munich has 2 packaging-free stores. Let me know down in the comments if I'm not right about that. But neither of the stores is anywhere near where I live, and they're not really very easy locations for me to integrate into my daily schedule, making it really stressful for me to try to shop there. Whereas I've heard that in Berlin, some of the larger supermarkets are starting to have some packaging-free sections, making it easier for those residents near there to use less plastic on a daily basis and incorporate that into their life without making it a huge stress and burden for the individual person, which is better for the planet and just everyone involved, you know? So yeah, it really does make a difference if we as a society decide that we need to figure this out and we need to do it together and make these changes together. So my question for you is, what tips do you have for reducing plastic consumption? And Are there any societal changes that you've seen taking place where you live or other places that you've traveled to around the world? What would you like to see your city do on kind of a larger scale, you know, to use less plastic? Please let me know in the comments below. Thanks so much for watching, and a really, really, really big thank you so much to the Petra Kelly Stiftung for working with me on this video. Be sure to check out the Plastic Atlas. I've linked to it down in the description box below. It is packed with so much information created in a really easy to digest way. I cannot recommend it enough. They're also doing some events with the Plastic Atlas in Bavaria at the beginning of next year, so be sure to check them out on Instagram and Facebook as well. Until next time, auf Wiedersehen!